Hi everyone, welcome to the 2020-2021 Computer Science Capstone on ORSAT Live Handoff. We are going to go through all the things on ORSAT Live and all the software that you guys have written over the last 6 months and see where you guys are at and hopefully get a demo and look at all the places on GitHub and Google Docs that you've left your documentation for us to find so we can continue this project. Do you guys have a way you'd like to start?
I was just going to screen share and go through your original proposal. Then we're going to jump into a demo, then GitHub stuff.
That sounds great. Let's do it.
Cool. Okay. So this was the original proposal. These are the, I guess we can just talk about the deliverables. So first was software that demonstrates end-to-end ORSAT Live. I think we have this done, as you'll see in a few minutes. Encoding decoding scheme, including FEC. We also have that. I'm not sure we've really codified the thoughts on trade-offs and options for future work in a single document, but you can find like bits and pieces throughout the meeting notes about what we've discussed and GitHub issues. And finally, development and build, that's all documented on GitHub, how to build things, et cetera. I guess let's just start with the demo. I think Alex has an end-to-end demo set up.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So I'm actually having a lot of trouble, technical difficulties. So I do not have an end-to-end demo set up. I don't know what happened over the course of a week, but nothing is working, literally. So I am currently troubleshooting it, and I hope to have it back up in like 5 mics, hopefully. I don't know what's going on. So,
okay. But then we will step through the GitHub first.
I think that's a great idea.
Terribly sorry. I don't know how it got messed up. I tried to move my laptop to the other room so there'd be less Wi-Fi interference, but that just seems to have broken everything. I don't
Interesting.
Know why.
Okay. So. Shouldn't have written so much in the README. That must have broken it.
I don't know what's going on, but I will work on this real quick and hopefully we can fix it.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so this is where our like Google Drive stuff is. It's an ORSAT Share Drive, ORSAT Live 2021 CS Capstone. A lot of this is sort of auxiliary slash abandoned over time. I think the important things are the final presentation video. So this is what we made for Bruce, and this will eventually go up on YouTube. I think it's a good primer in 27 minutes about what we did. Then we have the meeting notes. So this is every single meeting sort of cataloged on what we did, usual ORSAT meeting notes style. Then we have a networking brain dump. So this is sort of our initial thought process about how we are going to do transmission. some of this is outdated at this point, but I think it's a good introduction of like the technology, sort of the stack. Then we have the original proposal we just looked at. Then we have the project document. So this is sort of a written version of the final video. Sort of a high level overview of everything we did, including some stuff on, so this is for the capstone. So there's some stuff on like timeline and project management, but this middle section about deliverables and software overview sort of goes over everything on a high level. Then we have, so these two documents, Raspi Zero and BeagleBone Setup, were just stuff we did internally to set up the BeagleBone in Raspi and document how we did that. Those would be useful. And then the important stuff diagram wise. So first we have, this is sort of our hardware block diagram, which we'll go over in this presentation. And then really the important one, the big diagram we made was this, which is the FEC framing diagram. So this goes over from an original image how we do the double forward error correction and packetize everything. And yeah, so this is all the numbers in here are up to date with the current values in the code. So this is sort of that diagram. So that's sort of our, oh, and we have test videos. So this is just, I believe demo videos is worth, yep. So demo videos is sort of output from our camera on a BeagleBone Black with our encoding software. So this is just a quick way to get some videos to test with.
Good. Can we go over the block diagram just for people on the call, just to refresh their memory and go over the big blocks?
Yeah. Yes. So this is sort of division, but this is a real block diagram. So starting at the very top, we have our camera connected via USB to the Octavo, which we tested mostly with the BeagleBone Black because it had a raw USB ports, but we also ran this on a Pocket Beagle a few times and it worked. Then we have a USB connector to the AR, I always get this one, 9271 on the other end as well. And then that's USB to Raspberry 0W, and then onboard Wi-Fi and access point mode to web client. Questions on anything so far?
No, does anybody have questions on this hardware block diagram? And this is what you have working right now, correct? Except for like demo effect thing.
Yes.
Okay.
So what you'll see is most everything going on a laptop just because we have to screen share or resume.
Sure.
But in the readmes and stuff, we have information on how to set things up on real hardware as well.
Okay, good. And then can you go up a little bit and we'll look at the next one?
Okay. For the...
Oh, I see. You guys had teams. Okay.
Yeah, so this is... Ignore this. This is sort of irrelevant. Yeah. This is how we divided it up. That was really a capstone thing.
Yeah. I like it. Can you talk about one of the things I was hoping for also is a software block diagram that shows all the sort of packages or the projects, software projects that you guys were doing independently?
I'm not sure that's, maybe it is in a diagram. No, that's also kind of a hardware thing. I mean, so there's basically like three pieces of software, like one for each of these blocks. This hands off videos in the directory, this hands off videos, like this takes in videos in the directory on one end, hands off videos in the directory on the other end, and this reads videos in the directory and spits them out over Wi-Fi.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah. You'll see that in action hopefully soon-ish.
Okay, so that's how you did all of your sort of inter-project communication is with literal Linux files.
Yes, yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Everything just either reads from a directory or outputs to a directory.
That's nice.
And both of these are, so the input to the transmit and the input to the server are both like directory listeners. So that's how they update based on new videos coming in.
And so just so I understand, the image gathering one grabs a video of some number of seconds, puts it in a folder, and then immediately starts another one. So it's we do have continuous video. It's just chunked up into files.
Yep, exactly.
Okay. Okay.
Cool.
And this, sorry, what's this all written in?
A lot of things. Let me open this again. So the camera stuff is C for the actual interface to the camera, plus Python for coordinating that with FFmpeg. All of the transmission software is C. And then the server is JavaScript, Node.js.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I would say most everything. It's C for almost everything, JavaScript on the ground, and a little bit of Python for multi-threading on the camera side.
Okay.
Cool. Okay, so I guess we'll walk through the GitHub stuff next. So first we had, so this is Orset Live software. So this contains this block, the camera block, and the ground server is in Orset Live software, split into the camera and server folders. So we have first the camera software, I mean, standard documentation about dependencies, compilation. Everything we did that was in C uses CMake for build, and then usage. So Chris, do you want to talk a little bit about the actual software, about the camera?
Yeah, so this program is actually pretty simple. We're basically just using the API to fill buffers and fill the frame data set with the stream from the camera. So if you go down to like the camera control function, I think it's like closer to the top. Yeah, that's just like a helper function that makes the call to the API for the camera controls. And we basically use that function to just request stuff from the camera API and like fill up the buffers and fill up the frame data set to be put into the to be put into the PPM files that are eventually going to get outputted. And we've got error checking and all that sort of stuff at the top there.
Yeah, API is V4L2.
Yeah, the V4L2 API.
There you go. So video for Linux.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right? Why is it 2? Do we know?
It's version 2 of the API.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Gotcha.
The kernel's changed a lot since V2.
Okay.
Yeah, that's...
Sorry, go back to the README for just a minute.
Mm-hmm.
So V4L utils and V4L dash dev, and the dash dev is what is the API that you're calling.
Yeah.
And then FFmpeg. Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
Cool.
I think I got it working, by the way, just FYI.
Oh, awesome. Okay.
Yeah. You can stop stalling now, Amer.
I'm just talking over here. Come on, Alex.
Yeah, so I had to switch out to use my BeagleBone Black. So I won't be able to demonstrate the camera because the camera doesn't work on my BeagleBone for some reason. And as of this morning, my Raspberry Pi worked everything fine, but then it decided that it doesn't want to work anymore. So I don't know what's going on with my Raspberry Pi, which I was going to use for the demo to demonstrate end-to-end, but I won't be able to do that anymore. So I'll just have to display demo videos that we pre-recorded demo videos instead
okay,
of live.
So we can demo the camera separately, basically. Cool. So this
let's do this. Let's continue to go down the code path and then come back to the demo at the very end.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that'll give me time. I can set up the demo for the camera real quick too.
Okay, so. Great.
Cool. So the C program basically outputs, grabs frames from the stream buffer, and it outputs PPMs, so just raw image data.
But what is a PPM?
It's just an ASCII image format, basically. It's human readable, actually. Just a couple of header bytes, and then just 3 bytes per pixel.
So we're grabbing images, not video from the camera.
We're grabbing images from the video stream. Okay. So basically we have this video stream on, so that starts the video stream, and then we just capture frames from that stream at the desired frames per second.
And is there a reason why that we chose PPM rather than a binary thing?
Because these PPMs just get sent straight to FFmpeg, which converts it to a video anyway. So
Over scattered out. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Cool.
Then we have the Python. Bailey, you want to talk about this?
Yeah, sure. So obviously, in order to get continuous streaming, we have to do encoding and video capture at the same time, because the output for the camera is a lot higher than what we're actually capable of streaming over the DX Wi-Fi chip. And so we needed to do multi-threading for the FFmpeg and for the camera. And in order to do that, we decided to use Python because it was the cleanest solution for this. Some of this code is Umair, so I can't speak as much about that. But basically the way it works is the camera outputs its frames to a folder, and then FFmpeg reads in that folder. FFmpeg has a certain utility for turning separate frames into an actual video with a specified frame rate, and you can encode that directly into a specific bit rate in just a single command with H.264 encoding. And then we just loop the process. So it starts off with camera capture, and then it loops as many seconds as we want it to. So I think right now we're capturing 3 seconds of video at a time because it gives us a better kind of compression rate. So it actually will capture for 3 seconds and then capture and encode for 3 seconds and do that for however many periods we want.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I'm gonna keep interrupting with stupid questions. So you start the camera starts streaming to memory, and then you guys are grabbing images from it, saving the images to a folder, and then you're recreating a video at a certain frame rate based on these images, and then that is a H.264 encoded video.
Yes, and I think we're doing it at, Umair, it's 4 frames per second, 3-second videos, right?
Yeah, that's what we kind of fell into, is 3-second videos, 4 frames per second. So it's 12 frames per video.
What's the relationship between the C and the Python programs, or is like one controlling the other, or
the Python calls the C executable to do the camera capture, and then for FFmpeg it's a direct call to the command line. It's just for FFmpeg it's just one command, which I think you can see there on line 72. So
yeah, a combination of this and this. Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
So to run this whole damn thing, you just run this program, camera.py.
Yeah, you shouldn't ever have to direct, I mean, you can, but like you don't have to interface with the C program at all. You can just compile it and run the Python.
Cool.
And that's why the C program just has like positional arguments, and the Python has the neat, nicer actual command line interface.
We approve.
So I think one more thing to mention is the bit rate. We actually found that FFmpeg, so we're not really sure exactly how H.264 encoding in FFmpeg works behind the scenes, but it seems like the bit rate doesn't actually affect how long it takes to encode. So we've just squashed this down as much as possible, and we end up around 100 kilobits per second of video, which is great and actually gives us a lot of room to play with.
Overall. It's also worth mentioning that the reason why we're doing 3 seconds of video at a time instead of 1 second is because FFmpeg performance doesn't scale linearly either with video length. So if we were to encode 1 second of video at a time over the course of 3 seconds, that would take up way more performance than like 3 seconds. So we found that for 4 frames per second, 3 seconds of video is basically the golden amount of time so that our encoding doesn't take longer than the camera capture, because otherwise we would get, you know, asynchronous interrupted streaming.
Cool.
Yeah, okay. I think that's about it for this. I mean, most of the camera software was really figuring out the, you know, resolution, the frame rate, bit rate stuff. So there was some trial and error involved there, but in the end, this is what it came out to.
So when all is said and done, there will be .mp4 videos starting to fill a folder.
Yep, exactly.
Okay.
And then next, we move to the DX Wi-Fi. So ORSAT DX Wi-Fi software contains the transmit and receive. This is what's on ORSAT 0, or like an early version of this is what's on ORSAT 0. So the readme here is pretty long. The introduction kind of goes over some background and motivation. I think the main things to mention are how the packets are framed, so the headers we attach. And then maybe the real main thing is FEC. So our FEC is pretty much based on the master's thesis paper from the Polytechnic University of Catalonia, which was, this is something that was already in our, like, you guys had already found this, so this was in the order already. So that is a two-step FEC encoding process. So first we do low density paired check encoding, and that's with OpenFEC. And what that does is correct for packet losses. So basically this is encoding entire blocks of data. And then we put those already encoded packets through a Reed Solomon encoder, and that corrects for bit errors. So we have these sort of doubly encoded packets, which can correct for both kinds of errors.
That's okay. This I always wondered how you were able to do the block thing. Okay, that's great.
So,
if I might interject,
yeah, go ahead, Chris.
With how it's set up for release 1.0, please do not use the encode and decode files unless you absolutely have to, because it should automatically do that. So, yeah. Stuff like, if you try and decode it twice, it's not going to work. If you try and encode it twice, it's not going to work.
Yeah, that's good to mention. So this whole build system actually creates four programs, decode, encode, RX, and TX. But you really own, at this point with our, I guess it's worth showing off, we set up the actual release system. So yesterday we have V1.0.
That's awesome. Yeah.
So it's worth noting that these two programs, encode and decode, are sort of obsolete. I mean, they still work, but the TX and RX
programs, well, they're internally called.
Yeah, they're called internally by TX and RX to do the actual work. So these are just sort of around for testing and things like that. So we have sort of repository explanation. So we still have the previous DXWiFi capstone, which previously had this repo. That's all archived. Then DXWiFi is actual source code. LibDXWiFi is what we call our shared code. So this contains like shared header files, shared functions, and all of like the other header things we're using. For example, the 802.11 headers are all stored in here. Then we have, so we've just directly brought in both OpenFEC and RS code as folders in here for dependencies. Then we just have some testing and cross compilation stuff. And then in the README, you can, I won't go through this, but you can read how to do all the compilation and stuff. So basically, if we, maybe I should just do this. Okay. Oh, there we go. So we have a lot of options available with transmit program and receive program. Now, most of these you can sort of ignore because they're set to, you know, same defaults. But, you know, you can modify the code rate, whether it turns a daemon, file delay, packet loss, et cetera, et cetera.
I could walk through this, if Mayor, if you want.
Yeah, go ahead.
Around with all these. So the first block of mainline options are mostly for like how you want to transmit it. So you have code rate, which is the number of like FEC repair symbols you're going to get per symbol, source symbol. You got dev, so you can name what device you want to capture on. Default, I think, is mon zero. Daemon mode, which will, you know, fork it as a process. And then enable PA, that's something we did for ORSAT zero. So that will turn on GPIO chip 319, I think it was, believe. And then we have some other options as well, like file delay. So if you're doing multiple files at once, you can specify amount of time between each file. And then so, and if you do multi-file transmission, there's this other option called redundancy, which is the number of extra control frames you'll send. So what happens is when we transmit, we send a preamble control frame, and it tells the receiver like, hey, you got a file incoming. And then once that specific file is done transmitted, we send an end of transmission. So if those control frames get lost, the receiver will bleed the file boundaries together because it doesn't know when a specific file ended. So that's why if you're doing multi-file transmission, you can turn up the redundancy of this cold control frames. You send like 100 of them per file, and then you can pretty much guarantee that you're not gonna have messed up file boundaries. And some other important ones, delay is a good one. If it's pretty noisy environment, you can like delay the number of seconds, milliseconds between each packet. So that'll help make sure that packets get through. And then if you're listening for at a directory, you can specify the glob pattern for the file name that you want to transmit. So if you only want to transmit MP4 files, you can specify the filter. And then the rest of these command line options enable you to change different values within the IEEE 802.11 MAC header itself, specifically the address that we're going to stuff in there, as well as the radio tap header options as well. But most of those have same defaults. Unless you're debugging something crazy like I usually am, then you usually don't need to mess with that.
Cool.
Good.
I guess one thing worth mentioning is the save file. So that was sort of in real life, but when we're testing it, we make use of error rate and packet loss. So these are our error simulator options, kind of. Error rate specifies a percentage of bits to flip, and packet loss specifies packets to drop.
So this is your noisy channel simulator?
Yes. Okay. And we use that in conjunction with save file, which will dump things into a file instead of transmitting over the air. So that's kind of how we achieve that. I think one thing worth mentioning is that like these are not like probabilities. These are like actual percentages. So an error rate of like 0.001 means that actually 0.1% of bits will be flipped, not that chance. That just helps it be deterministic in terms of like, we want to make sure that if we flip that many, it's not actually zero, and we're happy that we corrected errors when there weren't any. So that's why both of these are like real values, not probabilities. I think, okay, more on testing. So we have a sort of somewhat continuous integration kind of thing going on. So we have a bunch of system tests that we run. So in test and test TXRX. So there's a bunch of tests in here that like transmit test files and make sure everything is working. And all of these will be run every time you push to git. Hence the little check marks you get on commits, like verified. So that means all the tests pass. There is also a couple other things in here. So data, we have the infamous photo of Alex's dog in here for easy access. Then a script to generate random bytes, and then sweep.py. So this is kind of what we use to sweep through a bunch of code rates and error rates and packet loss rates to kind of find the limits of FEC. So you can specify sort of min max step for each of those parameters, and it'll do like every possible combination of them and then spit out the results offline. That's sort of the testing overview. And then on the RX, it's really just the opposite pretty much. Alex, you want to talk about the RX flags as well?
Yeah, sure. So RX is usually easy. You don't really have to mess with any of this stuff unless you really want to. So let's see, important flags. You can open files in append mode. I just threw that in there. I don't think that's very useful. So I guess one thing to note is all the packets that's being received gets buffered into a packet buffer. So you can control the size of that too. So if you have some specific memory considerations that you need to modify, that's controllable. You can also specify the device that you're capturing on. So the packet buffer is actually ordered as a binary heap, array of this binary heap. So because of that, it can order the packets for you if you need it. However, because we have forward error correction, you don't need it. So you don't need to specify the ordered or add noise flags. And basically, if you didn't have error correction, you could keep the packets ordered in the heap and then fill in all the missing packets with some noise value. But because we have error correction, it's not needed anymore. And that's really, sender address. So sender address, that one must match the transmitter's address. If those don't match, they're not gonna talk to each other. They're not gonna be able to find each other's packets. So, but again, they're all defaulted to be working together. So.
Cool. Thanks. And you can also specify a Hamming distance sort of threshold. I think we have the set to a default type 6, maybe. I don't recall. But
it's a 5, I think.
Okay. Yeah, but we allow for some variation of the sent left, like the received address with our expected address, because we look at that before applying error correction, so that can be mangled. But you can change that if you want to and only capture exact matches and stuff like that. Cool. Other things. Okay, I think that covers like the interface.
So talk about how to actually run this.
Sure.
I could show you.
Demo. And that'll show how to run it.
I can also do like from like a fresh clone, building the software, getting everything running up and turning on your Wi-Fi interface to monitor mode. Do you want to see all of that?
I don't think we necessarily do. Well, if other people think we should see that, then we should see that. But I think what I'd rather see is just a discussion of understanding how the thing is run. So yeah, I guess the demo would be good. Since we're talking about the software though, let's continue into the receive side and then go back and do demo stuff.
Okay. So I mean, in terms of code, there's a lot. I'm not sure we need to step through everything, but I guess we can go through the server and then come back and talk about code if questions arise during the demo about how specific things work. So the server is again back in the orsetlife software repo. It's in the other folder. So this is pretty standard Node.js stuff. Alex and Abby, do you want to talk about what's going on here?
Yeah, so we started with Apache, and after a few like iterations, we decided Node was better because you could actually transfer the files through that. So we've created a Node.js server that can run on the Raspberry Pi 0W and will run through just using node index.js and the directory that you want to listen to. The way that it will work is it'll listen into that directory and constantly check for any MP4 files, finding what the next possible file that hasn't been like played yet and was modified. Umair, do you think you can step into index.js for me?
Yeah.
Okay, and then scrolling down just a little, maybe closer to line 81. Yeah, right there, that's perfect. So basically the logic behind this is that it'll scan the directory. It keeps track of what the last modified file, the timestamp of the last modified time with the file associated. and it'll check for any files that have been modified since then, and it'll choose the one that was the most recent. From there, it'll update its current file that it's playing and the location of it. And so whenever any browser makes a call to this using app.get/video, it'll go through and return that file as well as the timestamp it was created and the duration of it. So we initially had, it does a duration because we want it to be able to time out if the file is stuck. One thing we've noticed is that when we are dealing with these video files, if there's a like corrupted piece in the middle of the file, it'll just hang. And so by actually having a duration that's passed in, it'll like execute the next video file, even if the video is hanging in the moment. Additionally, index.js, it's able to support multiple users. That's something we had to work through. So if there is one user or 30 users, they'll all be getting the same video file, and it'll kind of be playing at their like own phone's rate of going through those files. So there might be lag between like 3 seconds at most in between each person's like individual smartphone. And lastly, we do have a few videos just to have like kind of like messages about the stream. So we have a stream beginning video if there hasn't been any files in the directory. So we're just kind of waiting for that. Oh yeah, that's good. I think it's the wait, yeah.
Yeah.
So we have that one, it'll just bounce through. It's like a 2 second video, but the fade makes it look so it's a little more interactive. So you're not just waiting for this like screen that's not changing. We have an interrupt video. So in case we haven't received any videos that have changed in the last 5 attempts to get a video, it'll provide that. And then we have a stream ended. So let's say we haven't had any new videos within 10 like different attempts at getting a new video. It is to assume that this transmission has completely finished. So we'll play this. Yeah. Maybe we can go into videoplayer.js too.
Yeah, so this is client side.
Yeah, so on the client side, the way that this is working is we have a like a video player object in our HTML, which is consisted of 2 video elements. So one of them will always be like buffering and loading while the other one is playing, and they'll kind of switch off. And so using HTML like stylistic things, one of them is always displaying as soon as that has the on-ended signal, which is a component of the video object in HTML. Then it'll switch to the other one, start playing that one, delete the other files. So in case it was hanging, we can just start with a new like video element on the HTML side, and then query into the server, load that HTML or that MP4 file, and then play it. And it kind of just goes in a loop until literally the rest of the whole time that the server is up. Yeah.
Cool. So I mean, that's a node server. You can just run it on your laptop. In terms of running it on a Raspi, we found this really awesome README, which kind of does exactly what we want. So a to-do is turning that README into a bash script. We didn't quite get to that, but it really is quite simple, just following all of these instructions up to this point. So don't go past this point. But once you have this set up, basically what it does is route all traffic to a particular IP address that's static in a particular port. Once that's done, you can specify host and port environment variables to whatever you did with this sort of walkthrough. The fun thing to do is to set host to orset.live. So then once the server is running on the Raspi, you can connect to the access point. And then if you go to orset.live in the browser, it'll do the redirecting with the IP tables, and you'll see the server at that address. So cool. That's the server. Questions about that, I guess.
Demo.
Okay. All right, we stalled for long enough. It's time. Let's see what we have.
All right, let's hope nothing catches on fire again.
I'm ready with the camera if we want to show that first.
Yeah, that probably makes more sense.
Yeah, let's see the camera first.
Yeah, let's go down the steps.
Okay. All right. So I've got the IMX214 camera and BeagleBone Black all set up and hooked up, and I'm SSH'd into them here. So this is the usage command you'll see in the GitHub repository down towards the bottom. Mm-hmm. So first Python 3, obviously, that's the file name. So here we got frames per second. So we're gonna be making videos that are 4 frames per second, seconds per video, 3 seconds per video. The bit rate is 100. And we'll just do a 6 second capture. So like 2 videos, 4 frames per second, 3 seconds per video. We've got the input or the image output directory and the video output directory. So I'll run that and I'll just like wave in front of the camera so we got some motion or something. All right, and then I'll go over here, grab the videos. And there's the videos. And it's a black at the front because the exposure gets messed up a little bit.
Until you run it.
It's fixable, yeah.
Can you go back to the Debian BeagleBone? Debian and BeagleBone, and show us the directory listing of the two folders, encode underscore image and data videos.
So this is the encode image one.
Could you do a long listing?
What's
LSHL or LL, whatever you got. Okay.
Yeah. Umair, do you want to, I think you set up this directory.
So in each of those directories is the frames for that particular video.
Right.
So if you LS.
And they all get removed at the end or else they'll.
That was the question. I mean, they can be. So by default, they don't. They should still be in there. So if you LS code image, they should still be there. But there's
I think
an option.
I think they get removed at the beginning of every cycle, right?
Yeah. So if you rerun the it'll delete the old ones, but you can just set a new directory as well.
I could grab all of those and we could look at those too, but
that's okay. Can you do an ls-l on that same directory though? Just so I can
And go to 0, 0.
Yeah. Fascinating. Okay. And so that's what I was going to ask, which is if you run this 100,000 times, do you fill up your disk image? And the answer is no. We wipe the directories, the data directories, every time you run this. So I would, if we were doing a 10-minute pass, we would expect to see this fill up, but then the next 10-minute pass, we'd just delete it and do the whole same thing again.
Yeah. So if you look at the command here, it's like deleted existed directory, deleted and created new directory. Ah.
There we go.
And you can also, there's a flag. So you can delete the raw frames at the end as well, if you don't want to keep the raw frames. I mean, that's off by default for testing, but you can also just delete everything when you're done and just keep the videos.
What's the longest you guys have run this video for?
I've run it for 3 minutes.
I've done a full 5 minutes. Okay. Yeah.
And no problems, right?
No. Okay. It works good.
Awesome. Thanks.
Yeah. The one question I have, you said that after 10 attempts, you stop. So my question is that long enough, Andrew? Because I don't know what the time is between the attempts.
Let's re-ask that question when we get back to the receiver or the server, the node server that does that. This is on the satellite.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, but that's a good question. I had the same question, actually. All right, are we done with this part?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yep. That's awesome. And
then, yeah. So in the video directory, you would just find the videos that those frames came from.
The same videos that I pulled down from the BeagleBone.
So okay. I have a question. The other question is, if it goes over 10 minutes, does it start rewriting over it?
No. I mean, so let's see, each frame is like a megabyte. And if there's four megabytes per second. I mean, we can go for a long time without really worrying about running out of space.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, just want to be sure.
All right.
Yes, can everyone hear me and see this?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So these terminals on the left is the OrSAT, right? This far left one is going to be act as the camera software process. This one is going to be the transmission daemon. And then here's going to be the receiver. And this last one is going to be the node server. So first we'll do, do you want to see the picture without FEC and with FEC again? To kind of see what, or do you want to just jump into the full on end-to-end portion?
Up to you.
All right, well,
we can look at the FEC. Let's look at the FEC. I think that's fun.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, so first, so I have an older version of DX Wi-Fi installed. So that's why, and the old version, I think it's 0.1.0, did not FEC encode it by default. So we're gonna run that version here. So right here, as I'm setting up the, I'm setting up the receiver to listen, to create a new file called Daisy No FEC. I'm putting it in verbose mode, and in verbose mode, it'll tell you all the settings. Like it's looking for a specific AA.
Sorry.
Yeah, yeah, I get it, yeah. So it's looking for that screaming address, and it's gonna attribute that to this file. So for the transmitter, again, we have the old version installed, which does not FEC encode. All it's saying is transmit this DAISY file, which we have in the repo, and give me some verbose output. It's pretty simple. That's not the password. And there's the password. So it'll transmit it, and on the receiver, it'll tell you, let you know, like, I found it, and I got the end of transmission, which is good. So now we'll do the same, but with FEC. So this is the latest version. Oops, that's not the right one. So we'll set up the same command, but we'll name the file Daisy FEC. And then this one is gonna be the exact same command as well, but now we'll FEC. So first thing it's gonna do is FEC encode it. So you can see it's kind of stalling here. And then boom, we got a lot of output. So this is also a debug build, which is why you're getting all this data. In release mode, it does not spit out nearly as much data. And then it's gonna FEC decode it. And we should, hopefully, cross our fingers, get two pictures. So one that's completely mangled, that's no FEC. And one, that's come out perfect. So that works. So this is all because the data is coming in out of order, and then these white dots, squares are just missing data in general. So that's how that works for single file transmission. And then,
wow.
Yeah, it's a pretty big difference. But OrSAT, the way that it's designed is kind of to do a bunch of multiple videos at once in one transmission. So we'll show you how that works. So what the TX program supports is for listening into a directory with four new files. So if you just specify a directory as the argument, it's going to know the context of what you're trying to send, whether a single file or a directory full of files. So if you give it a directory, it's going to activate this DirWatch module, and it's just going to listen for new files. And then for the, oh, I should probably turn on the server foot first. So node is clear. Now let's see, node index JS demo. So we'll open the browser. Boom, you can see that we are waiting for transmission. And this is playing those demo videos that Alejandro showed. So for the receiver, we're going to tell it to output all the videos in the folder that the server is listening for. And we're going to give the extension as an MP4 file and verbose mode. So boom. All right. It's starting to listen. And lastly, we will. So here I have this video folder, which is just a bunch of pre-recorded videos. And to simulate the camera actually capturing and delivering those videos, I'm just going to copy them into the directory that the transmission program is listening for, which is actually this one. So I want to press enter. See, now it's starting to FEC encode each one and transmitting it. And this is doing the opposite, decoding it. And if we bring it over here, we get a video that's being played and some weird green stuff, but that's, I think we fixed that actually. So, because this is a pre-recorded video from an older version, but yeah.
It's worth mentioning, the green stuff is part of the video. That was an error in the video recording. That's been fixed since. That's not from the transmission.
So yeah. If I gave you guys, what do I want to say? Some high res video from the ISS, and you guys we broke it up into little 3-second videos at the right frame rate and stuff like that. We could run this, and as a test, we could send the ISS video, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah.
I actually tested it with something similar.
Yeah. I'd like to see that just to get a sense of what it'll look like. That'll be interesting. Okay. Great.
Yeah. So we tested it. I've tested it with some random videos too, like random videos off the internet, a bunch of pictures of my dog. And I've also ran it as a daemon process. I ran it for almost a week straight and just retransmitting the same file over and over, and nothing got on fire. I can also walk you through like how to build it and the different configuration options, because you can actually turn off logging completely if it ends up being something you don't want to compile into the binary. There's also runtime asserts and debug asserts that you can completely compile out of the program if you don't want that extra baggage in the binary as well. So those are some other options that it has.
So Ed brought up the question of attempts a little bit back on the server side. So that's basically sort of the first pass, I would say, of trying to figure out where the stream ended. Is just, if we haven't received a new video in 10 times the duration of a single video, let's just call the stream ended. There's obviously, you know, ways to improve upon that.
Right, and Ed's right, which is that's not the right thing to do. The right thing to do is to always just wait for a video clip, you know, kind of thing, and not ever exit, because it could be 30 seconds, it could be a minute before of dropout until we get more data, or that they've repointed or something like that. So that's fine. But the nice part is that all seems configurable. So.
Yeah, what you just mentioned should take like no more than 5 minutes to actually implement.
Yeah, okay. This is cool. Let me think about this for a minute. So on the satellite, we have a BeagleBone essentially sitting there, running Debian, and it gets a command saying, hey, go ahead and start. And so it runs camera.py and grabs the data, starts filling a directory with videos. And then at the same time, it also triggers off TX, which grabs the videos, encodes them with FEC, and starts firing them off Wi-Fi. On the ground, the kids are already powered on and running the Raspberry Pi, which is running RX and grabbing data as it comes in. and reassembling the little videos, and then also running Node.js to serve those to the any smart device that's associated with the access point and going to orsat.live. Is that yes. accurate?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, good. I just want to make sure that we understood the whole damn thing.
So Andrew, do we ever figure out what the latency is from the time the satellite's overhead, it starts taking pictures to the time it would show up actually on someone's computer down below?
No, the two nice things. The first is we don't care what the latency is because we don't care. And the second is that even if it was long, as long as they get the video, it's fine. And it's going to be really dicey for the first like minute or two as we go from like, you know, a couple thousand kilometers away to right overhead, which is 400 kilometers ahead, over 400 kilometers away. Like at 400 kilometers, we'll get data nice and loud and clear, and we will not have much noise or drop packets. At 1,000 kilometers at acquisition of signal, I don't think it'll even work. And so it's going to be, there's going to be this dicey period as we kind of go through, and somewhere 700, 600, whatever, we're suddenly going to start to get real data. It's going to be noisy and terrible for a long time until we kind of
it's going to drop out and then reconnect. And,
yep. And then, so you know, the kids are going to be hitting each other with the thing. And, you know, as they hit each other, it's going to go off and they point it again, and they hit someone else and they point it again. So it's, you know, we're going to be dropping frames and videos all over the place and it'll be fine. This is great. I want more CSE people to start poking questions at these guys.
What's the performance like on the BigBlueButton Black with all the stuff running?
So you saw that the demo. So that was a release build, and we were able to get almost no. The bottleneck was actually the camera portion. The transmission port, as FEC encoding, actually works out pretty fast. But yeah.
Do you know how much CPU time you're using?
I had those numbers somewhere, but I don't have them right now. I did look it up one time, but it also was on a different version too. So I'll have to rerun it and collect those heuristics for you.
Yeah, you don't happen to just like know like ballpark, because I was just curious if it's like using like 80 or 90% of the CPU.
When FFmpeg is running, it's going to be 100% all the time. Encoding videos is absolutely the biggest bottleneck that will take everything up. Yeah.
Okay.
But you said encoding videos, you mean?
Encoding, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, can you guys just take 10 minutes and just rewrite FFmpeg in Scratch and see?
You should have put that in the requirements document. Then maybe you would have done it.
Damn it. Yeah, actually, you would have, because you nailed everything else. See,
That's a project for another CS capstone.
That's right. Yeah, no, it's good. The point I think we saw, though, was that live it was working. It was 100%. So it's going to be close, but it was working.
Yeah, yeah.
That's great.
I have a question. So I know you're using like a certain percentage of packet drops or bit flips or whatever to test like the FEC. Did you find that there was a certain threshold where the FEC like would stop like being enough to fix the errors, or would it work under pretty much any condition?
I think Alex knows the numbers better than I do, but around 1% bit error, like 0.001 BER, is kind of the threshold.
Actually, I had this calculated out, but the way the Reed-Solomon encoding works is we're able to correct. So we have 32 bits of parity that we Reed-Solomon encode it with. So, and we have 5 Reed-Solomon blocks that we encode.
Did we lose Alex?
Hello?
I think we lost Alex.
Yeah, I think so as well.
Daisy got him. he's gone. Okay.
Hello?
Hey, you're back.
Oh, sorry, I'm back. I'm having the worst time with technical difficulties today. Nothing's working. Did Amir answer that question or no?
You dropped that when you said we're encoding 5 blocks.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the something, it's actually for the percentage is about like 10%, not 10%, under 1% that we can for bit errors, but we can support like about 10% of packet loss about that. I had these numbers, but again, I'm just a complete mess today. So maybe I'll come back with those numbers for you.
Okay, cool. Is that like what you'd expect for when ORSAT's like actually up in the sky, or like how lossy do you expect that channel to be? No,
really good question.
Yeah, so that is the question, and we'll let you know fall 2022 when we're so in space.
If I can expand on that a little bit, we had a handful of conversations right at the beginning. And we whatever parameters we chose for this FEC thing, we chose fairly conservative ones because we wanted a minimum viable product that would probably work when we sent it into space. And then, you know, as the capstone went on, you know, the focus came on, you know, making the whole system work instead of improving the FEC. But I think adding different types of FECs for different thresholds is something that I want to work on going forward.
Yeah, when ORSAT is in orbit and we're giving this the first tries, my guess is that we're going to see a very different world than we predict right now. And my guess is that these systems that we've got working right now will work flawlessly when there's, you know, we're within a couple hundred kilometers and we've got the link budget for it. But it'll be really interesting to see as we get out AOS and LOS, and then Gavin can step in and we can start to sort of tune the FECs to deal with those areas. So that's great, Gavin.
Yeah, the number we had basically, and I have no idea how accurate this is, but was a BER of 0.001. And we can account for that right now. So if that's anywhere near accurate, then yes, we can account for that.
Yeah, that was we were speaking with Glenn a while ago, and that was like a 10 times what we thought the kind of high end would be for a reasonable range. But I mean, this is like 90% guesswork.
So I'm gonna link a pull request that I made that actually fixes the Reed Solomon encoder. And I kind of talk about like the maximum symbols errors we can correct for. And then I quoted the Barcelona people and they talked about the number of parity symbols. So I think, so from those calculations, which I don't know if they're correct, but I calculated for at most 80 errors before the CRC check will fail. So, but maybe there's a little bit more reading there.
So Andrew, will they be able to do any work adjusting the errors during the balloon test this September?
I that's going to be a really good question. Yes is the answer. We'll be able to do stuff on the fly, assuming we get all that software written and done. This is great. So you actually use the CCSDS standard for this. That's great. They probably know what they're doing.
Yeah, that's been, was my whole mantra when writing all of it is,
yeah, that's great.
What everyone else has done.
So so everybody knows that in July, we're doing a fit test of ORSAT-1B in Houston. And then in September, we're flying this whole damn thing on a giant balloon that will go hundreds of kilometers away. We won't be pointing the satellite, unfortunately. We'll have a unidirectional or omnidirectional antenna mounted on it, but it will be the best test of this system that we'll have before flight. And so the idea is to get this system up and running and installed on the satellite before September 1st. So that we can actually try this on the balloon, like Ed said. And you know, if we get the damn thing to work and it gets us videos, we'll have won. If we can tune the FEC parameters the farther away we get, then we'll really have won. And I'm not sure how exactly we're going to do that quite yet, because we'll need to have some software written. And Gavin, we might bug you about this, so that we can send parameters over the VHF radio to the C3 and then get those parameters from the C3 to the Orsat Live thing over the CAN bus. So it's going to be a little complicated communication path. It's doable and everything's there. It just needs to be plumbed, if you will. So. And Gavin's doing his PhD, so he'll be around for at least the next 5 years. So we're good. Laugh of pain. What year are you, Gavin?
I started with a post-bac and then went to a master's, and that master's kind of bled into a PhD. Mm-hmm. But I'm supposed to pass my RPE like now.
Oh.
And then, okay. And then it should just be my dissertation from now on.
Yeah, so 5 years is accurate.
Yeah. And then I'm doing internships right now as well. So
awesome. Okay. Do we want to see them build this stuff? It's 1:10. We have a meeting at 2:00, so we have a hard stop then. What would you guys like to do in the meantime?
We're cool with anything, but whatever you guys want.
Ryan, John, I'll look to you guys.
I mean, it's just CMake.
Yeah, I've
seen CMake build several times.
Yeah, I mean,
it's fun to watch the output stream by. I didn't see anything that scared me, so I'm actually okay.
Yeah, all the build step-by-step stuff, like those are included in like the readmes and stuff, right, in the documentation? Yes. Just as someone who will be building this, you know, sometime soon.
Yes. The documentation tells you how to build everything.
Okay. Yeah, then I don't necessarily need a demo then.
Oh, one thing I forgot to mention. So on DX Wi-Fi software, we kind of organized everything with issues and pull requests. So if you want like a really detailed record of like what we ran into, you can look at closed issues and merge pull requests, sort of like how Alex just linked.
Okay.
We have two open issues, one of which is just code cleanup. So like checking the error from A to I, but maybe the main one is the packet interleaver. So this is the one thing that we didn't do that the Barcelona people did, which is interleave the packets after forward error correction. It seems like we don't really need it, or it seems like at least now it's working without it. But if we really want to match what they did, then that would be the next thing to work on. So okay. a couple of open issues.
Yeah, I'll be sure to look through those. I already wrote down the pull request from earlier, so
cool.
I'll definitely take a look at those.
I am going over your Google Drive right now. Do you guys have a final report?
Sorry, I was muted. That is the project document. The final report was a combination of, it's called final presentation dash slides and final presentation dash video. There was no written component to that.
Good. Okay. Can you rename project document to something more descriptive, like project summary or project final summary?
Yep, I can do that. Yep.
This is great, and this is very well organized. Thank you, guys.
We do day, month, year in Orsat, right?
What'd you say?
Day, month, year is the preferred format dates.
No, it's always year, month, day, always.
Oh, year, month, day. Okay.
Yeah, it's ISO 8860 or whatever it's called. And by the way, anybody else in any other format is wrong. like ethically wrong and morally wrong.
We are no longer wrong. Okay.
Thank you. And you've got the final presentation video there. Great. Okay, I see it. Yeah, if you guys are okay with it, I'm going to publish that to YouTube.
Bruce will publish that to YouTube as well. Oh. I mean, I don't know if you want to, but...
We want to because we want it under the PSAS channel.
Yeah, I mean, I had expected, like, this was due last Friday, and I thought it would be up by now, so we like could have people watch it in the fourth day. But it's not up yet, but I'll share the link when it's up.
Okay.
But yeah, feel free to put that on the PSAS.
Okay, and then this will go up there, of course, as well. Holy crap, you guys. Congratulations.
Cool.
Good job. You actually nailed it.
Nice. That's good to hear.
Yeah. That's all I've got. I'm willing to let you guys go unless anybody else has anything. All right.
Good job.
Yeah. Good job. I want to take 2 minutes and just say a thing, which is that we have been working on this project since 2005, right? In 2005, we actually did the first Wi-Fi transmissions from the rocket down to the ground. We were the first group to push my Wi-Fi past Mach 1, as far as we know, which is adorable. And we've always had this vision of this streaming service thing with streaming data coming down without the AP and without the all this unidirectional broadcast stuff, right? And especially with the satellite, we've been working on this forever. And we've tried different things and it's kind of worked and kind of not worked. And this is the first time we've ever had the full system from camera to a smart device working. And so congratulations. It was a huge, long pipe to get working. And we're really, really pleased that you guys got it to work. So feather in your cap, go flex on the fact that you got this to work and put it in resumes and all that kind of stuff. And we look forward to flying this both on the balloon and then in space. So cool. Thank you guys.
Great. Thank you.